Hello, everyone, and welcome to the Jeffrey Epstein Show. I'm your host, Bobbycapucci, and this is Daily Drop number 152, Santa Fe, Day 2, Recap Edition. So on Monday night, we left off, and I was talking about the ex-law enforcement official from New Mexico and the discussions that I had with them and the things that they were telling me about the Epstein case and how it corroborated a lot of what we knew and how I learned a lot of things that I did not know. And it's always nice to talk to somebody like that, right? It's always nice to talk to somebody who knows what was going on and who can give you a different angle, you know, from the inside, from somebody that was on the ground, somebody that was there when the actual events were occurring, when people were talking about them. So the law enforcement, the ex-law enforcement official was able to add some context to what we already had known, and it also they brought up some other questions and some other doors that need to be opened. So I've already started doing some research into trafficking in New Mexico, and I found some pretty horrifying things, folks. You know, there's a big problem with indigenous, meaning native women in New Mexico going missing, and I don't have any evidence that would tie that to Jeffrey Epstein directly, but there's obviously a trafficking issue in New Mexico, and the authorities really don't seem to care about it. They certainly didn't care about it when it was Epstein, so you definitely have to go with the idea that they're not going to care when it's indigenous girls. They don't have the time for that, right? We've seen with, like, the Highway of Tears in Canada, and we've seen, you know, several different instances where people, and especially girls from low-income households and neighborhoods, and especially indigenous girls, you know, natives, when they go missing, there's really not much effort put into finding these girls. And a lot of times they end up in these trafficking rings, and it's just a brutal existence for them. So I was doing a little bit of research into that after, you know, I had gotten home, and last night especially, I did some research into that. So that's something we're going to touch on at some point. We're going to get into, you know, a little bit more detail into that, because I believe it adds context to what we're talking about in New Mexico. Because like I've said, I believe there's a lot more that occurred here. I believe that there is a lot more going on, or was going on, in New Mexico that nobody has any idea about. That's how tightly the shroud of secrecy was pulled over this place. And it's hard for me to imagine that there is not more to the story when it comes to New Mexico. All right, so let's get into my day when I went and visited the Zorro Ranch. So I'm going to pick up right where I left off when I was leaving with the source. When I left the source, this is me jumping back into my car, basically, okay? So after I ended my conversation with my source, I headed back to the hotel. I couldn't stop thinking about the next morning and the trip out to Zorro Ranch. I was jazzed up, folks. So I had just got done talking to the law enforcement official, and, you know, they added some context to what we talked about, and they, you know, told me some new things, and I was really in the moment. I was catching the flow. I don't know, those of you out there that are, you know, into sports and stuff like that, there's certain times where you get into something called the flow and everything's just working for you. And that's how I felt after this conversation with the ex-official. So I was driving back to the hotel room, and, you know, I kept thinking over and over in my head about the trip the next morning, what it would bring, what I would see, what the layout would look like, and I was just so amped. You know, I had a long day ahead of me the next day, I knew that, but I had a lot of pre-planning to do, right? So I had all of that in my mind as I began the drive back to my hotel. I made a quick pit stop at the gas station off of Cirillos, and I grabbed a few Gatorades and some chips. I figured it was going to be a few more hours of researching and putting notes together and stuff like that, so I figured I needed some munchies. So I stopped in there, I grabbed myself some Gatorades, I grabbed some chips, and I headed back to the room. So as I was poring over my notes and shoving chips down my mouth, I was blown away by what the source told me, and I was disgusted that the same MO we have seen in New York, Florida, and the Virgin Islands was obviously present here in New Mexico as well. You know, when it comes to the officials looking the other way, how Epstein was able to spread the dough around and make it so nobody was really going to put the pressure on him. And if he did get caught, how he would be insulated by all the different layers of people that he had on the dole. And I was just blown away by the fact that an ex-law enforcement official was so disgusted by how things were conducted that they decided that they were moving on with their life and leaving the profession. And that's telling, right? It's not an easy thing to do, to leave something that you love or a profession that you love or a job that you love, but sometimes you have to take a moral stand, and that's what happened with this source. They had had enough, and they said, we're out. We're not dealing with this nonsense. We can't deal with it anymore, so we're moving on to other things. And that's what they did, and it disgusted me as I saw the pattern unfold in New Mexico right before my eyes that we had read about in, you know, Palm Beach, that we've read about in New York and the Virgin Islands. It was the same exact MO. Although I don't think he was running the same scam as in the going to get girls from schools in Santa Fe. I don't think he was employing those tactics of trolling the schools in Santa Fe because he wanted to keep the secret of what was going on down at Epstein at the ranch private. He didn't want it in the public eye. I haven't been able to find any evidence of him running that plot in New Mexico. From the evidence I've seen and from what I've been told, it was a spot where he brought the girls in with him. It was kind of like he would traffic the girls in with him and bring them in from wherever they were located originally, be it New York or, you know, Europe or Florida or whatever it may be. He would bring the girls with him to Zorro Ranch. Santa Fe, it only has a population of like 70,000, and it seems way too small for Epstein to use the same tactics at high schools that he did in bigger cities like in New York or Florida. I haven't discounted something occurring in Albuquerque. I'm not sure if they used the school plot or if maybe they just found girls at parks like Elaine did in Central Park in New York. But I have seen no evidence, and my source said they were unsure if Epstein and his trafficking ring were active in Albuquerque. But like I stated earlier, there is a ton of poverty in Albuquerque, and there is a ton of poverty in the indigenous regions with the indigenous Native American, reservations, excuse me, sorry, I had a mind blank for a minute, with the reservations. So there's a ton of poverty, and there's a ton of girls that are in the kind of situation that Epstein loves. But again, I don't have any evidence to prove that he was doing that in New Mexico. All we have is the black book with the names of the masseuses that we talked about last night. And, you know, who knows who those gals are unless they come forward. We don't know if they're of age. We don't know if they were young girls that were procured by Ghislaine and the other squad of monsters that were around him. We just don't know. So I can't really say one way or the other if he was running this same plot, this same scheme that he was running in Palm Beach in New York at the schools. I don't have any evidence of that. And I'm leaning towards him not doing that here because like I stated a second ago, I think it's too small for him to have that sort of operation, especially in Santa Fe. I think he would want to keep that ranch out of the public eye. And I'm sure he knew that there were rumors already about his behavior down there, and he wanted to mitigate that. So I don't think he was up to the same things that he was up to in those other locations in Santa Fe. So finally, after 2 hours of organizing my notes and finishing my research, I finally had enough. I was like, all right, time to go to bed. So I slept for a few hours, and it was one of those sleeps where, you know, you close your eyes and then your eyes are open and you don't even realize you were asleep. That's kind of like that's what it was like for me. I was awake right away that morning, and usually it takes me, you know, I'm getting old. I'm going to be 40 in a few weeks, a couple of weeks now. Gee, not even 10 days, 11, 9 days. So in 9 days, I'm going to be 40. So, you know, takes me a little while to get moving in the morning, right? I get up, got to crack my back, got to make sure my legs are working. I have to make sure my shoulders, which have both been operated on, make sure that those are in working order. And then I get up and start my day. Well, not this morning. I got up, I was spry, I was right out of bed, my knees didn't seem to creak, my shoulders felt good, and my adrenaline was booming. I was ready to go. It was, you know, I was awake right away, and I knew in a mere few hours I was going to be at that ranch. I knew that even though I wasn't going to be let in, and I doubted that anyone was going to talk with me, I knew that I had to see that location for myself, and I knew I had to go out there and take a look and bring back what I saw to the listeners of this show. I know that everybody listening was craving this information as well, and being that I was located so close to New Mexico, just a mere short flight, I figured, you know what, if not me, then who? So I had been planning this, as you all know, for over a month, and when I finally was able to be within spitting distance almost, I was getting amped up, folks. I was ready to go. Like everyone else, I had read about the ranch and how it was secluded and it offered the maximum amount of privacy that someone like Epstein could want. I was not prepared for the absolute vastness of this property and, might I add, the property of his friends, the Kings and Mr. Ford. I was not ready for what I saw when I got out there, and I've been very vocal about that on the podcast and also speaking on Twitter. It was a stark reminder of why Jeffrey Epstein chose this property. So I packed up my bags and did a quick idiot check around the room because I am absolutely notorious for leaving things in my room after checking out. So after I was satisfied that I didn't leave anything, I proceeded to the door and I opened it up and I was greeted with a blast of freezing cold air, folks. I am talking mountain, high altitude mountain cold air. I fumbled for my phone, and my hands and face were just blasted with this Arctic wind. So I'm fumbling for my phone. I'm like, oh my God, how cold is it? I click on the app and it says 10 degrees. Now, mind you, I'm from Las Vegas, 10 degrees. It might as well be minus 60 for me. It was so cold. So I look out from the doorway at my car, and the car is completely frosted over. The front window, the back window, the side windows. I threw on my jacket, and a quote from Logan Ninefingers, a character created by Joe Abercrombie, came into my head. And that quote is, "Once you've got a task to do, it's better to do it than live with the fear of it." And that's how I felt with the cold. I really didn't want to run out into it, but sometimes you just have to do things in life, right? So with that in mind, I made a mad dash to the office so I could check out. And then I did my best Olympic sprinter impression back to the car, which is not very good at this point, by the way. So I got into the car, I cranked on the heat, and I made sure my phone was connected to my Bluetooth. I had to get in the proper mind frame. I had to get the proper jams on. I had to get the soundtrack going. The journey was on. I hit the I-25 north, and I turned up the radio. I was bumping some Jedi mind tricks, and I don't know if you're familiar with the Jedi mind tricks, but it's some fantastic hip-hop music and definitely one of my favorite hip-hop groups of all time, right up there with Wu-Tang. And so it's definitely some stuff I like to listen to as I'm getting jazzed up, ready to do some show prep, or when I'm hiking, I definitely like to listen to Jedi mind tricks. You know, this is the sort of thing I listen to get fired up for the show, folks. I highly doubt Don Lemon or Anderson Cooper has the same soundtrack going. Anyway, I was on the 25, and then I hit the 285, and then I finally hit the 41 for the final 16-mile stretch run to Zorro. I was getting more amped up as the miles passed by, so as each mile was passing by, I was getting more excited to finally get my feet on the ground and to get a good look for myself at just exactly what this Zorro Ranch was. As I was driving, I was looking out at the desolation around me, and it was obvious why this ranch was located here in the middle of nowhere. Epstein understood exactly what he was doing, and he understood the psychological effect a location that is so secluded would and could have on those he was abusing. Epstein and Maxwell played many psychological games overtly and at other times covertly. Maxwell was a master manipulator in that regard, and the optics of the desolation would certainly help to promote the feeling amongst those they were abusing that there was no hope of escape. The mind manipulation was one of many ploys used to keep these survivors docile. We know that the grooming process used by Epstein, Maxwell, and those involved was very extensive. We know that Maxwell and Epstein were masters at the grooming process. So we know that it's also a psychological game that these people play. And once they get into your psyche and they give you that feeling of no hope and just an absolute desperate feeling where you know there's no escape, then they definitely have you. Because once you feel like you have nowhere to go, then what are you supposed to do? And the location was very important, in my opinion, playing a role in that, in the psychology of it. The same goes with the island. You know, you're down there on the Virgin Island, and we heard from the survivor who talked about how they were willing to swim home. I mean, talk about mental anguish, right? And being out here at Zorro Ranch, you might as well be in the ocean. It's the same kind of deal. Now, you might not have a shark swimming around to eat you or whatever, but you're in the desert. It is desolate. There is nowhere to go. So it's the same kind of psyche and the same kind of mental games that come into play. As I was wrapped up in my thoughts, the miles were passing by, and before I knew it, I was at the front gate. I parked my car across the street and gathered up my camera and my phones. I was again greeted by that son of a bitch named the cold wind. I was once again greeted by the son of a bitch named the cold wind, and for about the 30th time in the last hour and a half, I cursed myself for not bringing gloves. You know, I definitely should have had some gloves. I wasn't really expecting it to be this cold in Santa Fe when I got there. And the weather report that I had looked at a couple of days previously said the weather was going to be, you know, pretty mild. But I should have definitely had a pair of gloves because my hands were freezing as I had my phones and my phone and my camera out trying to take pictures and whatnot. And like I stated earlier, the signal was so bad. I wanted to do a live broadcast, but the signal was just so bad that there was no way that was ever going to occur. Laughing at my own self-made misery, I crossed the 41 and found myself staring at a long driveway. At the very front of the driveway entrance, there were some huge boulders and little black boxes placed in front of them on the ground. I believe they were cameras. I took some pictures of those, and I'm going to post them on Twitter after I'm done uploading this episode. So you want to check those out there at @BOBBY_CAPUCCI at Twitter. And you'll want to check out the pictures that I'm posting because I've been posting pictures of Zorro Ranch especially. And I think that these were cameras as well. And they were placed around these huge boulders. And they were, you know, they weren't even as you got into the meat of the driveway. They were just right out in front. So it was very interesting right away. You jump out of the car and you approach the property and you already see these little cameras staring at you. As I moved deeper up the driveway, there were signs everywhere about trespassing and that all trespassers would be prosecuted. I really didn't want to spend a night or multiple nights in New Mexico jail, considering I was there by myself and considering how connected the Kings are to all of this and Bill Richardson. I really wanted to get a closer look at the ranch. I really wish I had a drone, or I wish that I was 20 years younger and I didn't think about consequences or ruining my life. I really wanted to get a closer look, and I was hoping that somebody would, you know, come down and to let me in or talk to me. But man, next time I go, I am certainly having a drone, and I'm already in the process of putting together a bid for a production package to figure it all out, to get a whole team down there with me, you know, two or three people. That way we can really do this justice, do a full-on production package, and get things really cracking in the right way. So as I move deeper, again, you could see that there were several cameras strategically placed throughout the whole entire entrance. There was a sign that read, "Smile, you're on camera." So naturally, I smiled and waved and asked if anyone was watching or if anyone wanted to speak with me. Unfortunately, I did not receive a reply, and I stood there for multiple minutes. I stood there for about 10 minutes, you know, waving and trying to get somebody to respond, and no dice. Nobody was around. Figuring either they were either on their way out to confront me or they weren't watching, I continued to investigate the front gate area. From the gate, you could see several buildings. I counted 7. This was not the mansion and was more than likely a visitor's ranch hand quarters. I hung out in the driveway for about 10 more minutes, hoping someone would come out, and when no one did, I decided to walk back down the driveway out to the 41 to get some wider shots of the property as a whole. As I was standing at the fence, staring at the buildings, I tried to make out any human activity. I used the zoom on my camera as well. As far as I could tell, there was no activity on the property, and nobody was there. At least nobody was visible. I didn't see a person, I didn't see an animal, nothing. There was nobody out there. I decided that I would walk back up the driveway before I went and give them a little message from all of you. With that in mind, I went back up to the cameras near the entrance and proceeded to give them a double bird and held up a note that read, "From the listeners of the Jeffrey Epstein Show." Hoping that that might spur them into action, I went and sat in my car and waited for 20 minutes or so. Again, nobody came out. After taking a few more pictures and wishing that I had a full production package and team with me, I hopped back on the freeway to head into Santa Fe for the meeting with my source. So in total, I spent probably an hour out there. And, you know, like I said earlier, check out the pictures on Twitter. It gives you a better idea of what I saw while I was out there. But it was crazy how many cameras were located throughout the place. This man had cameras everywhere. Every single move you made while you were on this property, you're on camera. So I thought it was fitting that from my fantastic listeners, I'd give them the message from all of you. So I dropped them the double bird, right? Gave them the nice double bird. And, you know, hopefully my picture is posted now on their wall of infamy. Maybe they have one of those. And, you know, I thought that was a fitting message from the audience out there. I thought that, you know, that would be something that you folks would be on board with. So I got back into Santa Fe around 12 p.m. and I had a few hours until I had to meet up with my source. So I decided to take a quick visit to the museum. I love museums of all kinds, and I couldn't pass up spending a few hours walking around and checking out the history of the area, and specifically the Native American cultures. I won't get into all the details, but it was well worth the detour, and I highly recommend that you check it out if you are ever in Santa Fe. The museum was fantastic. There is a lot of cool stuff in that museum, and I'm an absolute nerd when it comes to this sort of thing, so I was blown away by the history of the region. You know, Santa Fe is like the third oldest city in America. It was like established in like 1604 by the Spanish. And besides, I think it's Jamestown and one other city. I forget the name of the other city, but those were the three oldest towns in America. So it was pretty awesome to check out some of the history of Santa Fe while I was waiting on meeting my other source. So I was able to really get an idea of some of the culture and some of the rich history in the area. And previously, I had read this book called Empires of the Summer Moon by S.G. Gwynn, I believe his name is. And it was about the Comanches. And the book absolutely blew me away and gave me a whole different perspective on Native American culture. So I was really, really pumped to check it out. So I highly recommend the museum if you're ever in Santa Fe. After feeding the dork that resides in me at the museum, it was time to meet with my second source. I hopped in my car and headed to the location. The location the source chose was a place I hadn't been in years. I pulled into the Chili's parking lot and hopped out of my car. I grabbed a booth in the back, and it wasn't long before the source joined me. We made small talk at first, and the source asked about my trip so far and what I thought of the ranch and how I liked Santa Fe. It wasn't long before our conversation turned towards the business at hand. A little bit about the source. The source worked at the Santa Fe airport and was in a position, the airport is not very big by the way, to see who was coming and going at the airport, and also had colleagues who talked about who they saw coming and going with Epstein or who was reported to be headed to the ranch. So there was always talk about who was at the ranch when they had big groups coming in. The source, we'll call this person source number two. Source number two would always talk with their colleagues at the airport about, you know, looks like Epstein's in town, or looks like Epstein's here with some more young girls. And it was like an ongoing thing whenever Epstein was at the Santa Fe airport. Let's see. The source said that what I had heard from source number one the night before about the helicopter in Ghislaine was all legit, and according to source number two, a person who worked at the airport said that Epstein always had several or more young girls with him. The source said they always looked to be in their teens, though they can't be sure of that. They can't, you know, they never went and carted them or anything like that. The source also talked about the helicopters and how they ferried girls from the airport to the ranch. The source said that anytime Epstein was at the airport, it was always the same story with the girls. The source also said that they heard secondhand about Clinton visiting the ranch several times at least, although the source never saw Clinton with their own eyes. So now that's the fourth source in New Mexico, either first or secondhand, that has reported about Clinton visiting the ranch several times. I also asked about Prince Andrew, and the source stated that they heard that he had been there, but again, they had never seen the Prince of Punk Asses personally. The source said that they couldn't remember a time that they were at work and had the Epstein crew there, that Epstein wasn't accompanied by young girls, not once, not twice, every single time that the source was at work and Epstein was there, he was surrounded by a gaggle of young girls. The source said that they had no idea how Epstein would got away with it for so long. If they were recognizing that these were young girls, how the authorities didn't ever recognize was beyond him, beyond them. How they had no idea. But you know, they just went about their business. They figured, you know, in hindsight, that's what they thought. But as it was occurring, they were just like, oh, there's Epstein with his young girls again. You know, as somebody working at the airport, your mind's on a bunch of other things. You're thinking about work. It's not your job to regulate, you know, who's coming in on these private jets. But it was so apparent that it was not only noticeable, but it was actually scuttlebutt between the source and other employees. I also asked the source if Dershowitz had ever been there, and they said that they were unsure. I asked that question because Dershowitz says he was only at the ranch one time, and one time it was with his wife and his daughter, and it was only for an hour. And Jeffrey Epstein wasn't even on property at the time. So my question is, why would you be at such a desolate ranch for 1 hour, about the time it takes to drive from Santa Fe, with your wife and your kid? Especially if, as you say, Epstein wasn't even home. What purpose would Dershowitz have at the ranch for one single hour? After seeing it for myself and where it was located, I have a hard time believing Dershowitz has only been there once. With that said, this source does not recall ever seeing Dershowitz there. Still, I am not buying Alan's story of 1 hour at this ranch. It's completely ludicrous to think that someone would bring their wife and their kid to that place for 1 hour. And it's ridiculous on its face. There is no reason for a 1 hour trip to that ranch. There is nothing out there. So, in my opinion, Dershowitz is being a bit loose with the truth again. And unfortunately, the source couldn't place him there, which would have been money in the bank, which would have been golden. But alas, that is not the case. With that said, I do not believe that Dershowitz was only there once. I believe Dershowitz was there at least several times. Look, I'm telling you right now, there is nobody that's going to that ranch for 1 hour. There is no reason to go to that ranch for 1 hour. You're either going to that ranch because you're staying there to, you know, take part in whatever sort of nonsense Epstein is up to, or maybe you're going there to use the facilities for multiple days. You're staying in the West World or something like that. But There is zero chance that Dershowitz was there for 1 hour. What was he doing in the region? What was he doing in Santa Fe? They don't have some vibrant nightlife in Santa Fe. What was he at the Santa Fe Institute with other sickos? Why were you even in the region? And we'll never know this unless Dershowitz gets, you know, subpoenaed or he's on the stand or something like that. Because we all know how smarmy he is. And I don't believe one single word he has to say, especially about Zorro Ranch. We finished up talking a bit about Ghislaine, the helicopter pilot, and how she would ferry guests. Again, the source corroborated what the Source 1 talked about the previous night, about the helicopter situation, ferrying guests to and fro, and specifically mentioned Ghislaine Maxwell. The source said he'd seen Ghislaine Maxwell tons of times at that airport. So, again, more meat on the bone, more context, and it shows us we're on the right track. It shows us that we are certainly on the right track and that we are definitely, definitely sniffing the right areas. The source also brought up Larry Vysotsky, who was Epstein's private pilot, and how he would also be the one flying the helicopter sometimes if Ghislaine wasn't available, or maybe Ghislaine was already hanging out at the ranch. I don't know. That's all speculation. But Vysotsky also flew the helicopter sometimes. The source remembers Vysotsky and says he was a bit of a braggart. And also Vysotsky owns 40 acres on Epstein's Zorro property. His daughter was married there in 2007. He's been Epstein's pilot since the 90s, and some people consider him a treasure trove of information about Epstein's activities. And you would think, right, his personal pilot, this guy definitely holds the keys. He knows who was on those planes. He knows what was going on. And especially if he was so close to Epstein that Epstein gave him 40 acres on the Zorro property, that's significant. He's another person who, in my opinion, should be subpoenaed right away. Being that he spent so much time with Epstein, he would be crucial in putting more context on the story, putting some more meat on the bone. Instead, we have another person who was involved in the criminal conspiracy, if we're looking at it from a RICO standpoint, that is walking around from it all without a single blemish. Meanwhile, the girls that were being abused while he was hiding out in the cockpit have to live with the burden that was forced upon them by the man he is helping to protect, and in fact, the man whose behavior he enabled with his silence. So, you know, I think that this man needs to be questioned. He definitely needs to be targeted by the legal teams as a witness, as a very important material witness, and he needs to be brought in for questioning. The source and I wrapped it up. The source and I said our goodbyes, and I thanked them for speaking with me before heading to my car to head to the hotel. I was letting it all settle in again, right? So when I was in my car, I was trying to figure out how this could just go on for so long in so many different places when it was obvious to just even employees at these places that something was amiss. How did law enforcement miss it for so long? Well, the only conclusion I can come to with the evidence that's been provided so far to us is that they didn't miss it, folks. They looked the other way. They looked the other way. They weren't negligent. They weren't stupid. They just looked the other way. And it seems to me from what I have uncovered and what from what people have told me, from what the sources have told me, the reason they look the other way is because the orders came from on high. And when you look at Epstein's connection to the Kings and Bill Richardson and various other politicians, you start to understand what they were talking about. Source number two added a lot of context to what I've heard the night before and was a second witness in a row to talk about the helicopters piloted by Ghislaine. I thought it was odd that certain people, VIPs, would be choppered over while others would be brought in by the ground. It seems that the local, quote-unquote, massage therapists were driven in, while the girls that he was trafficking over state lines would be kept close and as much out of sight as possible. So those would be the girls that would be getting ferried in by the helicopters. Like everything else surrounding Epstein and Maxwell, the curtains are slowly but surely being pulled back and the light is beginning to pour in, showing us the ugly scene that they have been hiding for so long, and each and every piece of evidence is crucial as we attempt to put this puzzle together. I was finally able to get to my room and begin to decompress. There was a lot to take in, and my adrenaline had been racing all day. I thought back to the ranch and what I saw when I went out there, and how bleak things must have seemed for these girls who were being abused at such a location, and how that burden has followed these survivors for their whole life, and how justice has evaded them at every turn, and the anger started to boil over. Anger at Epstein, anger at Maxwell, and anger at the whole entire system who failed these girls that were abused for decades at this location and others. This must never be allowed to occur again. The corruption at the highest levels of power is apparent to anyone paying attention at this point, and to sit idly by and not speak up in the face of such evil is something I am not willing to do. I am mortified by the behavior of the Justice Department, and I have no faith in their ability to bring justice in this case unless they are pressured. I believe with the right amount of pressure and the consistent outcry of rage where Epstein is concerned, that will push them into action, even if that is not the road they wish to travel. That wraps up the second part of the three-part Santa Fe series. I really appreciate you all joining me tonight for the Zorro Ranch Trip Day 2 Recap, and I hope you all enjoyed it. On Friday, I will be releasing the third and final part of the series. We will discuss the trip to Santa Fe Institute and my conversation with source number 3. If you'd like to contact me, you can do that at bobbycapucci@protonmail.com. That's BOBBYCAPUCCI at protonmail.com. Also, if you enjoy my work and you'd like to help out and donate, you can do that by clicking on the GoFundMe link inside of the description box. All right, folks, I will be back tomorrow with the usual scheduled programming. One morning update, and of course, the daily drop. I hope everybody enjoyed the program, and I hope you all have a fantastic evening.